Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Computer Wednesday. In today's episode we're going to take a closer look at NVMe, SSD and HDD. So let's dive right into it. So just a basic overview of what the heck these all things are. It's basically memory. To be specific, it's non-volatile memory. Basically, if you turn off the power, the data will not be erased like how it happens for RAM. RAM is a volatile memory. These memories that we are talking about is non-volatile, and this is necessary for your computer's processing. Basically everything like your operating system and your registry, they are stored in this, not in RAM, in this. Now of course data is taken from this and dumped into RAM and then processes it, but for complete operation of your system you need to have non-volatile memory. And after that, let's say you have a computer but all it's doing is running operating system, is pointless. So you store data in it, whatever it may be. It may be spreadsheets or it may be movies, whatever have you. So it also acts as a data storage, data banks basically. And it's generally all system, be it Raspberry Pi or be it your Apple iPhone or be it your Alienware, it generally has to be internal. So access must be internally available to the computer. And there are many types, like these are some of the types. So this is what memory really is. So before you understand which one to buy or which one to choose, you must understand there is always a balance, there is always a trade-off. So these are the four core components that you must balance out properly for your need. So first being cost, obviously, like you can spend boatload of money and get a best performance, but do you have the money? So first thing first, you decide the budget. Now in cost, there are two factors. First, obviously the cost itself. Second, cost per gigabyte, or basically dollar per gigabyte, dollar per terabyte. This is done so you know how efficient your expenditure is. So that is the cost. Then we come to size. Now size being how much capacity your basically hard drive, SSD or PCI Express NVMe has, how much data you can store onto it. So those are the two factors that everybody knows. Now then we come to speed. Now speed is limited by the connection that is presented between SSD and your processor, your hard drive and your processor. So there are multiple interfaces and bus that is used, like serial advanced technology attachment, or SATA is generally a very commonly used one, but it has a maximum speed limit of 600 Mbps. Now there is another new kid in the town, which is NVMe, which can go upwards of few gigabytes per second. 3 to 4 gigabytes per second is actually achievable very easily, and it will keep upgrading without needing any new reconfiguration. So this is the speed factor. Now then we come to the last factor, that is performance. Now many of you may be like, okay, storage device, doesn't high speed means high performance? Not necessarily, simply because let's say you are dumping a large video file in your hard drive or SSD, it's gonna go there very quickly. But let's say you have hundreds of small files that you are trying to extract, your speed goes down. For that reason, performance is a completely independent criteria than speed. Speed determines how comfortable your hard drive is, like what is your max speed. But performance describes how many operations it can handle. And in your basically Windows itself, you can find something known as queue depth, basically how much a request can be sent to your hard drive before it starts to fill up. Basically, if you have one or two queue depth, generally is try to be as close to zero as possible, but once the queue starts to pile up, your performance will go down, your hard drive will become slow. And I am not talking just slow that transfer speed is slow, like you will try to move your mouse, right click and all that, your computer overall starts to act slow. SSDs can handle upwards of 5 to 6, NVMe can handle upwards of 10 to 20. So this is why performance and speed are two independent factors. You do not need high performance, but sometimes you may need high performance, but you may not need high capacity. So there is a balance act. Be mindful of these. These are the four components that you have to decide on. So let's look at the old guy here, HDD. Basically, the hard disk drive comes from the fact that these are disk, magnetic disk, that is rotating and is storing data simply like by pits and stops. It's more or less same as a CD and DVD and Blu-ray, on which you can check my video. But instead of using laser to etch that, it's using a magnetic system to do that. So it's more or less exactly the same thing. It's just, it's a spinning disc, metallic magnetic disc. So the benefit of it, it's very cheap and very large. Large, I mean by capacity, as in you can easily get 2 terabyte very comfortably for very little amount of cost. And you can go upwards of 10 to 20 terabytes. Now 10 to 15 is easily accessible for enterprise. There are some rumors that 20 terabyte will come out soon, especially now we started to fill this hard drive with helium, because that allows a lower friction environment and actually allows hard drive to dump heat more effectively. Then we come to the consequence of this. It's very slow and weak. The throughput, the amount of speed you can get out of these sort of things, because there is a physical delay, like you have to wait your arms, like this actuator arm to move and read the data, there is a physical lag. Now, of course, it's built to do it as fast as possible, but it's still limited to, generally, even a very high-end hard drive will give you maximum speed of like 300 to 500 Mbps, barely. And most commercially available for public use is barely goes up to 200 Mbps. So do not expect speed out of it. Performance is good, but not groundbreaking. And it does slow down once the queue depth, basically how many requests has piled up, goes higher. This does start to slow down. So this is neither high, high speed nor high performance. So it's only cheap and large. Then we come to the form factor. There are many form factors, but there are two surviving form factor. One is 3.5 inch, which is now almost exclusive to enterprise and desktops. And then we have 2.5 inch, which is very common, and it's surviving in laptops. So this is the whole point of HDD, and it's a dying tech. It's not gonna retain its cost benefit for very long. So let's look at its replacement. We come to SSD, solid state disk. Basically, you can see there is no moving part. This is basically pen drive, and the memory chips, boosted up to 11. So it is very fast and efficient. Now, fast and efficient in this scenario means basically if you have a SSD, it can easily deliver the speed of 500 to 600 Mbps, basically maxing out SATA 3 bandwidth. So SATA 3 can't go faster than that. So SATA 3 can be easily maxed out using a SSD, and it's efficient, as in it requires very little power. So this is why it's very attractive for laptop users. You can have a very large SSD and don't sacrifice your battery life. So consequence of that, it's very costly and small. Now costly, let's say you can manage the cost, but problem is still small. You cannot go out there and just buy 2 terabyte hard drive, 2 terabyte SSD. You can buy them for enterprise scale, but the cost goes idiotically high, as in there is like a 13 terabyte hard drive is gonna cost you $2,000, 13 terabyte SSD is gonna cost you $15,000. So context, that's why I'm saying it's very costly and small in terms of capacity. Now there are two primary factors. There are many other also, but two are surviving factors of this, which is M.2, which is specifically created to act as a next gen small footprint system. The small footprint is done for notebooks, laptops and things of that nature. And then we have 2.5 inch, which was already created for laptops. This SSD industry simply used that, so it becomes intercompatible. And using SATA directly, they didn't have to re-engineer the wheel, basically. And so this is the most common type of SSD that you're gonna see in most people's home laptops or desktop. So this is the SSD. This is the replacement for your basically hard disk drive. Over time, as more and more technology will progress, this will go farther and further, because at the time SSD came out, it was barely 60 GB. Right now you can easily buy 1 terabyte. Of course it's idiotically expensive, but you can buy it. And speed on current SSDs are mind-bogglingly fast. Not only speed, performance also is very top-notch, and they come with very long warranty. Like I have a Samsung SSD which has warranty of 10 years. It's not possible to give that long warranty on anything mechanical. Then we come to the king, basically NVMe Express. As I mentioned earlier, there is a mini interface that allows your processor to communicate with your storage device, mainly is SATA, serial attachment technology. Now it's all well and good, but it was like holding SSD technology back. So people got together, as in all the manufacturers, Dell, HP, Samsung, and these people got together, and they created a new whole interface, which is using PCI Express. So processor manufacturer don't have to change anything new, nor they have to create a completely different, you know, bridge. As many of you remember, old days we used to have North Bridge, South Bridge. This used to handle communication between these. Nowadays, all these bridges directly into the processor. Right now, processor itself takes care of this. So all we have is PCI Express. So using PCI protocol itself, they take the protocol, wrote the software for it. So using that software data line, it allows direct access between your memory and your CPU, and it has the same speed that is you know, your graphics card gets. So speed wise it's top notch, and given the fact that they did not tamper with the PCI Express requirement, basically they did not like okay, redesign the PCI for this system, this allows them the advantage that as PCI Express technology progresses, as in, let's say we are at PCI 3.0, PCI 4.0 is starting to come in, and PCI 5.0 will come 4 years from that point, it's gonna get updated automatically. They don't have to change anything physically. It's super fast. As in, you can get a Samsung, basically something like this right now. You can buy it from Amazon and you will get upwards of 1.5 gigabytes of write speed. That's idiotically fast. Like, to give you a context, a normal Blu-ray will be written to this so fast that you won't even notice it. And then we come to the fact that read speed on these things are twice of that. So even though you are writing at 1.5 gigabyte per second, which is multiple times faster than SATA 3.0, you can read even faster than that. So right now you can easily get buy, like you can just go to a market and buy it, a SSD that can give you 3 gigabytes of read speed. Basically that means if you are, let's say, put this in a computer, workstation computer, and you have multiple software trying to read data off of it, it can easily handle it. Heck, even writing multiple data, it can easily handle it. The queue depth of these sort of things are very high. And this is what basically enterprise grade are jumping into. Enterprise is directly going from HDD to NVMe. NVMe. So they are not going into SSD. Specifically SSD that is using PC, basically SATA lane. They are just using the same chip. Because SATA was a limitation, they throw that away, and then they implemented this infrastructure, which is NVMe. And it is extremely expensive, as in hyper expensive, as in just 256 GB of these puppy will cost you equivalent of 1 terabyte of SSD. So cost wise, this is very, very, very prohibitive. And then we come to the fact that it is small. So right now you can't just go out there and buy 5 terabyte of this. You just can't. It's not even available. Even for enterprise grade, only few companies make them. So it's not only blindingly expensive, it's very small. And there are many form factors for this, because in the earlier days when the NVMe was established, the format of the connector format was not stabilized, so they directly used PCI Express. As I already told you, it uses the PCI Express similar to your graphics card, so they didn't need to, you know, redesign some South Bridge or another type of bridge. It can directly communicate. So enterprise may use this, consumer may use this, this is used for large scale enterprise. So as you can see, this will replace the SSD. Now SSD to this is a very simple jump. So if you go from hard drive in your computer to SSD, the performance you know, jump is day and night. But if you go from SSD, which is using SATA 3.0 as its limiting factor, to NVMe, you will not notice it. Now the reason is not that it's a fake performance. Performance is real, the speed gain is real. The problem is operating system is not written in such a way that you can actually take the advantage of it. And enterprise grade, they write custom software for these sort of things, so they can handle it. So let's say you put NVMe drives into your network attached storage, of course then you're gonna get a very huge speed boost. But this is right now, as I talk to you, gives you marginal benefit compared to SSD. So don't jump into like this. You can, even though you can buy this, be mindful, this will not give you day and night performance difference. And not to mention, softwares can't use this properly. Like even games can't actually, you know, take data out of it, because it can almost match your RAM, but there is no software architecture that allows it to, you know, extract data as effectively as it can. So enterprise has solved this problem. Windows still have a very long way to go. So this was my presentation on NVMe versus SSD versus hard drive. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it. I would urge you to leave a comment on this topic. So what you wanna see in the next episode of Computer Wednesday. I would ask you to subscribe and please share it amongst your friends. And if you are free, press the bell icon. And as always, thanks for watching.